So we are privileged to have her to speak to us tonight on the philosophy of realistic medicine. Dr. Colby.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you very much to Geoffrey and to Colin for the kind invitation to speak, particularly as this is your first meeting of this season. So the Chief Medical Officer is also an obstetrician, and I'm the only Chief Medical Officer ever to still see patients. I'm also the first female Chief Medical Officer in Scotland. And so I have three children. And my children used to understand what I did for a living. So I went to work to help the ladies who were having their babies. But when I got this new job, my son and I were walking into school together. He was holding my hand and he said, "Mummy, this new job of yours, it's all about keeping people healthy, isn't it?" I said, "Yes, it is, George, it is." He said, "I'm not going to ban sweets, are you?" I said, "No, George, I'm not. I'm also unlikely to ban wine." Don't say that publicly. So one of the roles of the Chief Medical Officer is to write an annual report every year. And that annual report is a snapshot of the health of the nation. So a lot of data, a lot of statistics, and of course in Scotland what essentially it sums up as is too much alcohol, too much sugar, too much tobacco, and not enough running around. So I did that with all of the data, which is very helpfully presented in the second half of my report. But what I decided to do with the first half of the report was something a little different. So I wrote an open letter to the medical profession in Scotland and asked them if we could practice medicine differently. Because when I was going out and about around the country, I was hearing from my medical colleagues that they were not feeling that the medical profession was being listened to. That they were feeling that their status had been eroded. They were feeling under pressure of time, pressure of volume of work. And they also felt that they were sometimes being pushed into practicing medicine that wasn't the medicine that had taken them to medical school. So I wrote to them and asked them six questions, and I'll talk to you about those in more detail in a moment. But I have then asked for feedback because I didn't know whether what I was thinking about medicine would resound at all with other people. But in fact, it has been widely recognised and welcomed by not only by doctors, but by nurses, by pharmacists, by physiotherapists, by paramedics, and by people not only in Scotland, but all over the world. So the social media that is Twitter, which you may or may not think is a good thing, I like Twitter because I can get the 140-character snapshot of the news before I get out of bed in the morning, and then I have myself psyched up for what the radio is going to be asking me about later that day. So Twitter has shared my realistic medicine report 5 million times all over the world. And I haven't had a single negative comment. So what I asked the medical profession was that could we practice realistic medicine? So should we be changing the way that we're practicing medicine? Change it to shared decision making? And to build a more personalised approach to care. So I'm going to tell you two stories. The first story is about a man in Ayrshire. When you're the Chief Medical Officer, you get invited to visit all sorts of parts of Scotland. And when you visit, lots of people are brought forward to speak to you. So I went to Ayrshire and this man came forward to be introduced to me. And they told me that he was speaking to me because he had recently had a knee replacement. And I said, "Hello. How's the new knee? Are you pleased with your new knee?" "Not really." I said, "Is it not working? Are you in pain?" "Well, you see, doctor, I didn't really want a new knee." "What was it you wanted?" "I wanted a grab rail." "So you wanted a grab rail?" "Yes, because I like to stand on my doorstep and speak to my neighbour. And my knees were sore, and so a grab rail would help me do that. Now, I still haven't got a grab rail, but what they've given me is a knee replacement. And I still can't stand on my doorstep." So I wonder, and I'm sure the clinicians who saw that man, that the knee no doubt had osteoarthritis, no doubt it was bad enough to have the necessity of a knee replacement, but actually that wasn't what that man asked for, nor did that man get what he was actually prioritising. I'll tell you another story. This is about a man in Lanarkshire. Now this man has an unusual hobby, as you can tell. He also has pigeon fancier's lung, perhaps unsurprisingly. So this has meant that over the years he is regularly admitted to hospital. His lungs deteriorate year on year, as you might expect them to. He has onset of breathlessness, he gets a little bit worse, he comes in and out of hospital. So a phone call came, a friend of mine was on call, geriatrician, a care of the elderly physician in Lanarkshire, and the call came in that this man was once again breathless and could he be admitted. And Graham has started a new hospital at home scheme in Lanarkshire, where people are unable to stay at home to be looked after. There are virtual wardrobes by Skype, and nursing staff come in to give them medication every day. And Graham said, maybe this man would be suitable for the hospital at home. So he decided to go out and visit the man, but nobody had ever been in this man's house. Graham went in, interviewed him. Yes, indeed, he was very breathless, probably didn't need to be admitted to hospital. And Graham started the conversation with him about the pigeons. You can tell where this conversation would be going. Well, you do realise that your lungs are getting worse because of the pigeons. You do realise that if you got rid of the pigeons, you would stop deteriorating, you wouldn't be admitted to hospital, you might live longer. And he could see the man's daughter in the corner of the room sort of beckoning him. So he stopped the conversation about giving up the pigeons, and the daughter said, I think, Doctor, you might like to see my father's back room. So these pictures aren't very clear because this is a tiny little room. And you'll see that those trophies, those pictures are portraits of his pigeons. He has a portrait of every winning pigeon. He then believes actually that they stopped winning. He is actually, at one time, was the UK's best pigeon racer. And those sheds that you can see in the bottom corner contain 200 to 300 pigeons. And his prize racing pigeon was sold for £30,000. So what did the daughter say to Graham? Doctor, he's not giving up his pigeons. Will you stop asking him to do that? He would rather die than give up his pigeons. He goes to the hospital every 6 months, they give him the lecture about the pigeons, he comes home, he goes back into the sheds, he stays with them, he talks to them, he feeds them, he loves them for 2 or 3 hours every day. He's not giving up the pigeons. So I wonder, when I ask people, what is it that is the priority? We can give medicine to this man, and in fact, Graham kept him at home. He hooked up the IV antibiotics to the standard lamp in the sitting room. He gave him an injection of IV hydrocortisone and left him at home to be looked after there. But do we really talk to people about what their priorities are? Do we really enable people to have that personalised care? I'm going to let Alistair tell his own story. Caroline is a renal physician in Edinburgh, and Alistair agrees to tell us his story.
Well, I would say my current medical condition has not improved in the last 2 months. And to that point, at the early part of this year, I was very unwell indeed. At the moment, I'm much surprised how much I've improved after the treatment I had in the renal department. And it was all done, in my opinion, through close consultation with other specialists, the GI people, for example, who came to a very good team decision between me and yourselves. And I'm delighted at my current situation, because I thought I was going to fall off the edge at one point.
What were those decisions?
We discussed it with the team, and they said, well, the step ended with the news that it might prolong your life a considerable extent. They'll straighten up with having a shorter term with quality of life rather than just dragging on in the same old drugs and everything else. They've decided to come off his work when he was younger, 18 years. He's too healthy and that was it. And he was also on amiodarone, which a pharmacist can tell me is a mild thing. It makes it sound like poison. But, so I've come off amiodarone and I'm in it. And I was given another one to control the bugs in my stomach. And since then I've been through day by day.
If you're deteriorating to the point that dialysis might be considered in another patient with that level of compunction, what's your understanding about dialysis and what's the ability to refer to you?
Well, I've been in hospital with a lot of people that didn't have any dialysis and so on. They made a decision, not a family, but a decision that that's the right thing for them. And they don't just ask you to do what you want to know. Just ask me, are you good enough? I don't think I could.
Why not?
I don't want to be every second day in here. I've got so many things wrong. And Dallas was just part of the whole thing.
We sometimes talk about shared decision making. Is that something that you recognise that's happened in your care?
The condition I'm in now, I thought it was due to making shared decisions between my consultant and doctor, and that has been all the difference to me.
Have you ever felt under pressure not to have a particular treatment?
No.
I think as doctors we sometimes find it very hard to be very honest and explicit to patients, particularly when it's around really bad news. How do you feel about that?
It doesn't come easy, but I'm sure it's part of the job, and I don't think it should be done cold with it either. You can't just suddenly tell them, don't buy a season ticket or put on an album next season. It's the benefit of both the clinician and the patient, and some sort of report established. 90% clinicians, doctors have great bedside manner, but some other people who still got to learn it. And I'm, as an outsider, I don't know how you do it.
So, Alistair is one of Caroline's conservative dialysis clinic patients. The conservative hemodialysis clinic is so conservative that, in fact, you don't get hemodialysis at all when you attend that clinic. So, where did all of this come from? Where did this thinking come from? I think, on reflection, it's from several things. I think, as an obstetrician, we have, in maternity services, always had our women, as most of them, are not ill. Patients in the same sense as people who are using the NHS for other reasons. And we've always had quite a holistic approach to our pregnant women and their partners, their families, their other children. And of course, we also give women choice in where they're going to have their babies and in what way they're going to have their babies. So I think perhaps my background as an obstetrician has helped. The other thing that happened was that I read a lot of research about doctors and the choices that doctors make at the end of life. So at the end of life, 88% of doctors would not have hemodialysis, 95% of doctors would not agree to have CPR to be resuscitated in the event of a cardiac arrest, and 67% of doctors would not be admitted to intensive care at the end of their lives. And that made me think, well, what is it that I know that would make me act differently to what people do for the patients? Well, of course, in fact, the patients get all of these things offered to them. And in fact, that's not what the doctors would do for themselves or their own families. A recent study in the New England Journal of Medicine, and this was Americans, but they took a group of patients and a group of their physicians, and they spoke to the physicians about what they thought was important for their patients. And the physicians all said, well, they want to live longer. So what I'm going to do is do whatever I can do, intervene in whatever way I can, give them drugs and medication to make sure that they live longer, because that's what they want. And then they spoke to the patients. And not a single patient prioritized living longer. The patients all said two things. One, I want to be symptom-free. And secondly, I want to spend time with my family. So what is it about the disconnect between what the medical profession and other healthcare professionals are doing that actually isn't necessarily what the people we're looking after are asking us for? And the third thing then that happened was the Montgomery ruling, which is a legal ruling following the delivery of a baby who had severe disabilities in Lanarkshire some 16 years ago. That court case has just come through about 2 years ago. That lady had a big baby, she had diabetes, and during delivery the baby got stuck. There was a degree of shoulder dystocia, and the baby ended up with the difficulties, lifelong disabilities, very significant. So when this case came to court, what happened was that the case was presented about the risks of a cesarean section electively for that lady versus her having a normal delivery. And she said that if she had been counseled about the risks of anything happening as did happen with her son, she would of course have opted for an elective cesarean section. Because any tiny risk, no matter how small, was not going to be worth taking for the outcome that she ended up with. And the court ruled in her favour. So previously in the UK, what we had was that practice had to be what any reasonable doctor felt were the risks that needed to be explained. And any reasonable doctor practicing in a way that was similar to the case going through court. But we now have the Montgomery ruling. And what the Montgomery ruling would say to us is, it's what the patient thinks are the risks that we need to be consenting for. Not the doctor, but when the patient has the procedure explained to them, where would it be that they would place the risk? So we have a UK legal precedent which actually can now be applied retrospectively to cases that are coming through the court. So I suppose what I think is that this puts the patient at the centre of what we're doing. I have three children, so I have to tell three children the latest story. So this new job of mine, it takes me all over the place. I've been to Hampden on the football pitch to have my photo taken. I've been to Barcelona, as Colin said. So we were driving to school one day, and my middle daughter Anna said, "Mummy, what weird things are you doing today?" Well, I'm going to a conference to speak about outpatients. And there are far too many outpatient appointments, far too many outpatients coming to be seen, and we need to do something about it. By the way, there are 4.7 million outpatient appointments in Scotland every year. There are only 5.2 million people seeing the everybody wants, and it's So I said, this outpatient issue, it's a big issue, we need to do something about it. And she said, "Mummy, what's an outpatient?" I said, it's a patient that is it in the hospital? She said, "Yes." I said, well, they come to the hospital or to the clinic and we see them and then they go away again. And she said, "Well, where do they go? Home, or back to work, or back to school, or back to whatever they were doing." And she said, "Isn't that a person, Mom?" So I wonder whether the people formerly known as patients get embroiled in our healthcare system, and we sometimes maybe forget, like our vision fancy gentlemen, that they actually have other lives and have other things to do, and that our bit of their life is not necessarily the most important or as important to them as we think it might be. So in asking my questions, I came also to talking about reducing harm and waste. And what I talk about is that waste is traditionally energy as a big wasteful system. People think about waste as being things that are thrown away. But I would actually talk about waste as being when something is done that doesn't add value. That is in fact wasteful. If it isn't adding value to the person that we're treating, then that is a waste of resource, a waste of medicine, a waste of money. And I talk also about unnecessary variation in practice and unnecessary variation in outcome. So if I tell you that I see a lot of data, I go to a lot of conferences and I sit through a lot of audits. So in my own practice of obstetrics and gynaecology, if I told you that the hysterectomy rate across the UK varies by a factor of fivefold, and the induction of labour rate in Scotland is 32% in one hospital and 18% in another hospital. And I'm not prepared to blame the mothers, the babies, or the wombs for those differences in practice. And I looked then in other specialties. So if we take hip fracture, the commonest fracture in numbers, very debilitating. We know that the outcome is better if you have your hip fracture repaired with a hip replacement within 36 hours. When we look at what the total time that people are in hospital after a hip fracture, that varies across Scotland from a median of 13 days in one unit to a median of 23 days in another unit. And in one unit in Scotland, 63% of people get back home after their hip fracture, and in another unit in Scotland, 95% of people get back home after their hip fracture. And I'm not prepared to blame the hips or the elderly people for those variations either. When I look at urology, the rate of cystoscopy, so minor bladder symptoms need a bit of a look in the bladder, the rate of cystoscopy varies across Scotland by a factor of fourfold. Again, it's not the bladder's fault. So everywhere I go, I look at these data and I ask questions. I don't know what the right rate of hysterectomies is. I don't guess what the right, or more than I guess, the right rate of induction of labour is. But I don't talk to the orthopaedic surgeons about how long people should stay in hospital. So I ask the questions, and in fact people are often very surprised by these differences in data, these differences in how the best units are performing in a small country compared to others. So I think we need to reduce this unwarranted variation in practice, because what it leads to is unwarranted differences in outcomes. People do less well if their hip is not repaired in 36 hours or less. So I talk also about managing risk. Managing risk, of course, in our Scottish world-leading Scottish Patient Safety Programme has made huge differences to hospital mortality rates, to our infection rates in hospitals, big falls in these, which were our major, major issues. And Colin kindly talked about the work that I've done in reducing stillbirths across Scotland. Our stillbirth rate has been static for 20 years in Scotland. Our stillbirth rate has fallen by 18% in the last 4 years since we looked at stillbirths, the causes of stillbirths, and decided not to accept that stillbirths just happened because they just happened, and actually did something about it. And so there were 100 families who took a baby home last year, 100 more families who took a baby home last year than had taken a baby home the year before, because we managed to prevent those 100 stillbirths. So that's very important. But managing risk, of course, is very sophisticated. And the senior decision maker who takes the riskiest decisions is often the medical professional. Other professionals also do, but the doctor is often the one who is taking those difficult decisions. But do we realise that when people are under stress, when they're overworked, when the volume of work is greater, then it is that decision-making about risk that disappears first? So people become very risk averse when they are stressed. So I wonder whether we actually support our health service colleagues, our nurses, doctors, physios, pharmacists, paramedics, because actually what they will become is risk averse. They'll make poorer decisions, and that will affect outcomes. Do we manage this better by supporting our staff better? So I also talk about becoming improvers and innovators. So I think that people think that innovators need to be inventing a machine or a cure for something. But in fact, what I have seen is innovation everywhere I've been to. So I've been to some of the wards where the most junior doctors were telling me about their quality improvement and practices. So during very junior doctors, one of their tasks, any of you have been junior doctors, and one of their tasks is, of course, to take the blood. There are phlebotomists to help, but the doctor always ends up with the most difficult cases to get blood from. So what the junior doctors realised was that there were always a lot of blood tests left over at the end of the day that hadn't been taken. What they also realised was that this was actually delaying discharge for some of these people because the result was being expected by the consultant, the result wasn't ready, and in fact the blood hadn't actually left the patient's arm. So what they did was they filmed on their iPhones, they filmed all of the steps that is from someone asking for a blood test to that blood test getting the result in the patient's note. And they realised that during that process there were 8 redundant steps, either repeated or not needed at all. So they chopped out the 8 redundant steps, they spoke to their phlebotomy colleagues, they got a system much more efficient, and they actually reduced the length of stay on that hospital ward. The most junior, cost nothing, and yet those people were the right people to be changing their own system because they, as the junior doctors, are the ones that knew where the changes could be made. But I also talk then about bigger improvements, bigger innovations. And what I ask about is whether, in fact, we are actually implementing the practice in medicine that we already know works well. So you'll be familiar perhaps with the need, the guidance to give people aspirin if they've had a cardiovascular event, a stroke or a heart attack, you get aspirin and that will prevent to some extent a second event. And most people are eligible to have aspirin. In Scotland, how many people who are eligible for aspirin get aspirin, I wonder? Stroke, might get another one. Let's give you something that costs £1.50 to prevent another stroke. Pretty simple? Well, only 57% of people who are eligible for aspirin actually get it. So, what do we do about that problem? Well, what we did was, we thought, I don't know, let's do a lot of work in the lab and come up with another drug that's much more effective. It's called clopidogrel, and it is more effective. But it would need to be 90% more effective to have the same effect as giving the other 43% of people aspirin who are actually eligible for aspirin. The drug costs 10 times as much, and I'm afraid it's only 10% more effective than aspirin. Well, I talk in my report about translating what we know in research into actual practice on the ground. And I talk about the importance of research being actually relevant to the NHS and the importance of research into treatments or medication that's actually going to be used by the NHS. Perhaps maybe moving away from research for research's sake. And actually moving into something where public money is being spent to improve our outcomes. So maybe we need some research into why everybody doesn't get aspirin. Not inventing another drug that's a bigger, better aspirin. So I talk about that, and I talk to academic audiences about that. They don't necessarily feel that I'm necessarily the most popular person in the room when I challenge them like that. But I think it's important to ask the question. This, after all, is public money. So, you'll see on my slide that the infographic has been shared all over the world, and what people have then said is we're not sure that we really like this realistic medicine. It's a bit medicated. And I said, well I'm a doctor. I'm the chief medical officer, and I wrote to the doctors, so that was where this came from. But actually, a lot of different groups would like to have their own version of realistic medicine. The pharmacists would like it to be called realistic medicines. And then it's been suggested that it should be realistic health care, or in fact perhaps realistic health and social care. And I have no problem with that, because I think what this has become is a way of talking about practicing medicine differently. And whether that's medicine or healthcare or health and social care, I don't mind. So this is the Twitter stuff, in case you didn't believe me, and that's the 5 million, I think. Some of you may or may not know Sir Muir Gray. He is really one of the founding fathers of public health. He invented screening as we know it, and his comment was, Catherine Calderwood, I was understated in my praise. It's one of the best documents I have read in 44 years. And these are a lot of government documents. So where do we go? What do we do? Where do we go next with this? So these are some of the comments that I thought the Philosophical Society would like to talk to me about. And I was very pleased actually to be coming back to Rotter Row. I haven't been in Rotter Row since I was a medical student in Glasgow learning by obstetrics in the maternity unit, so where better? So is this just emotion? I told you some nice anecdotal stories, and we peppered those with some jolly lively stories about my own children. So perhaps this is just emotional. Someone has said it's enlightened. Is this a new way of thinking? And our medical schools around the country have said that they will put realistic medicine on their syllabus within the curriculum. It seems to have a global application. My Barcelona conference has now got spread to Quebec City and an invite to Salzburg in Austria in December. Does it maybe bring back the art of medicine? A little bit more art with the science. And I wonder, does it play to the very well-known Scottish intellectual and philosophical wisdom? And maybe that's why it's been well-received as it has. What I have done, though, is really try to make sure that it is joining up with the vision of the Scottish Government. You may or may not have had time to read the National Clinical Strategy for Scotland, but you'll find within it a chapter on realistic medicine. And what I'm saying to my ministerial colleagues, my government policy colleagues, is that I think that some of these difficult decisions that have to be made about healthcare can perhaps be made better if we're practicing the various aspects of realistic medicine and bringing the patients or the people along with us on that journey. And so far, I haven't had any dissent. So I would propose to you that perhaps this is a new Hippocratic philosophy. This puts my doctor colleagues back in their positions of leadership. It is absolutely about the multidisciplinary team. Absolutely must be. I couldn't do my job as an obstetrician without the midwives. Couldn't do my job as an obstetrician without the healthcare workers, nor the theatre assistants, nor the person who cleans the theatre after the cesarean section. So I am absolutely sold on the multidisciplinary team. But the multidisciplinary team needs leadership. And the leadership often falls in the palms of the doctors or the most senior member of the team. So I wonder if we can also be creative. Certainly it's about empathy, always has been. But perhaps the medics, the doctors, the healthcare professional, whoever that may be, is more of a facilitator, more of a collaborator. And they definitely need to be a communicator. Big study in the 1970s interviewed medical students when they started. They start medical school very, very, very person-focused. And they leave it disease-focused. But it isn't diseases we're looking after, is it? So it's perhaps that person at the centre of the care that we should be talking to. So I'm coming to a close now. This was a cartoon that somebody sent to me. You may be familiar with the Scottish Intercollegiate Guideline Network, the signing guidelines. And Boyd Peters, who's a medical director in NHS Highland, he's a psychiatrist, he's written a drawing of my business manager, Mark, standing at my door, or some wise guy doctor on the phone, asking for the signed guideline for realistic medicine. Which has made me think. And once I can track down John Kinsella, who's the chair of the signed committee, I perhaps will put it to him that maybe we do need a guideline for realistic medicine. So I hope it's meant something to this audience. I'm very Grateful, as I say, for the invitation, and I know we've got plenty of time for questions and answers. I leave you with my contact details, so email me, tweet, look at the blog, because I hope that realistic medicine really takes off and goes somewhere, but it won't do it without support and without feedback and comments. So thank you very much.